Well, this year is the first time that we've seen this plant. This is a Salvinia minima. That's the scientific name. It's actually a fern. It's not a flowering plant. It's an introduced thing, probably brought in from most of our things like this are from South America. It's probably brought in originally as an aquarium plant, and then people take it out and maybe a water garden overflows, or they discard it into the lake. And so it is not a flowering plant. It reproduces from spores, so it's in the fern group. But this is the first time that we have seen it on Gunnersville this year.
Has it ever been seen in the past, or it's the first time ever?
It's the first time ever that we've seen it on Gunnersville. Now, we have seen it on Pickwick, and there's another related species that's a larger, they call giant salvinia, and it's much more aggressive than this one. And we're thinking that some of the giant salvinia might have come up on barges coming up through the Tin Tom. And of course, once this gets into the lake, the winds just move it around. We were over in Short Creek this morning. There are big mats that are being blown by the wind. And you know, it's like a mile and a half over there. So, you know, this could have come in with an accidental dumping of an aquarium. It could have been in a pond or something, you know, up above the reservoir, and it flowed in. It could have come in on a boat. You know, as you load your boats, you know, you can get it between the boat and the runners on your trailer. So we really don't know just how it got here, but it's scattered over 5 or 6 miles of river right now.
David, on a lake this big, are you guys ahead of this now? Do you feel like you're at a disadvantage a little bit already over 5 to 6 miles?
To the cameras.
Okay.
Or can you, and how do you treat it?
Well, I would say we're already at a disadvantage. I mean, it's scattered over 3 or 4, you know, river miles. So, but it's still small colonies. So we're, you know, we feel like we need to treat those. I guess we're sort of an unknown how well it's going to overwinter. I guess our assumption is that it will maybe overwinter back in some of these little embayments. But, you know, it's scattered. We're behind, but still, you know, it's small enough populations that we feel like it's worth trying to treat them at this point.
And is this the only way to treat it? I know he mentioned maybe coming in and putting some of those oil spill barges in.
If you were to put a containment barrier here, you could hold it in this area. But like I said, it's scattered over 4 or 5 miles, so you obviously can't do that on all the places that we know it is. So the best approach right now is to target with herbicides. You know, we survey and then go in and pick the areas that we know where it is and treat it. That way, we feel like we can reduce the populations.
And talk about the impact it has on the lake and the fish and everything.
Yeah, why do we want this thing gone?
Yeah, what's the danger of it?
Yes.
Well, obviously, it's not a native plant. So, and most of our real weedy things are not native things. That's not a 100% rule. But you can see how it's going to float in here and just potentially take over coasts around all these boathouses. I doubt if it has very much value for waterfowl, since it is an introduced thing. You just end up with a big old floating mat here, and I don't know whether it'll be a real problem on it propellers yet or not. I don't know.
What would it do to fish? Does it take oxygen and sunlight?
Well, it'll just shade it out. Yeah, I mean, it'll just occupy a niche here, and I mean, whatever's under it, it won't grow. I mean, it'll make such a mat that it'll shade it out.
So nothing could grow on the bottom underneath it if it got matted up thick enough?
Well, yeah, it just cut out all the light. I wouldn't say nothing, but it'll certainly alter the ecosystem here.
Negatively.
So that would affect fishing, knowing that, Guntersville is a $1 billion asset to this region. How would that affect fishing, or could it
My assumption is it would negatively in the long term. Right now, there's such a small amount of it, it's probably no impact.
Yeah.
But if you just let it go unchecked, and it takes over this whole area here, which, you know, it got a good start going early in the summer, it could. So we're just, like I said, right now, I'd say the impact would be negligible, but it's, you're looking down the road what the impact might be.
And it just makes things not as pretty. The people that live over here.
Right, I'm sure if you ask the homeowner, they may like it when there's just a little bit of it, but it won't stay just a little bit of it. So from an aesthetic standpoint.
Is the treatment similar to what you already use on other?
Yeah, it's one of the EPA approved herbicides that we use.
Okay. So it's nothing that you guys have had to scramble to kind of...
No. And Stephen can probably speak better than that, but the herbicide we're using is one that we've used for 40 years.
Gotcha.
And how long does that take to treat it? How long does the herbicide, takes to treat it?
For it to die?
Yeah.
Since the first time we've treated it.
I'm not sure I can answer
that. This product should.
I mean, Diquat is a contact herbicide. So I would anticipate within a few days you're going to start to see it yellow up. Stephen, you may have treated more.
Yeah, it should. I mean, it should be a day or two. You should. And within a couple of days, you'll be able to tell the difference in a day's time, but in 2 days, it should.
And how fast does it spread?
I don't have numbers on for going from one plant to 50 plants. I really don't know, but it reproduces vegetatively. In other words, this will break off, and then next thing you know, it branches and gets larger and larger. So we were through this area here probably in August, Stephen.
Yeah.
And we would come in around all these docks to determine other treatments, and we did not see it here 6 weeks ago. Now that doesn't mean there might not have been a few small plants, but certainly there was not anything like this. So, we think this amount of growth right here has probably just been in the last month.
It can, according to the literature on it right now, the biomass can double in under perfect growing conditions can double in 10 days to 2 weeks. So you can look at...
Ooh, that's exponential.
Yeah, one plant's 2 plants in 2 weeks, and then 4 weeks is 4 plants, and, and it's 8 plants.
It's probably never going to grow out in the open water, but we have all these hydrilla mats, and other vegetation mats, so it'll be a perfect plant to grow on top of them. It's going to collect in these little areas, these little inlets, like you see here, which is where a lot of our houses are. So
we have eelgrass, salvinia, hydrilla, milfoil, coontail, other stuff, native lilies. Is there a way to contain it or kill it, or is it management?
The only way you can eradicate something, you got to be on it really, really early. Generally, you end up in a management mode pretty quickly. Most of the plants that we have on Guntersville, eelgrass, believe it or not, is a native, and it's been a real strange why it's expanded so. But the milfoil, the hydrilla, the brittle naiad, the other thing that we've been seeing, we're going to go up and look at water hyacinth. It's an invasive exotic, Cuban bulrush. Now we've got this salvinia. So within the last 5 or 6 years, we're just seeing more and more of these introduced, plants that are coming in.